Education Director, Fort Rucker, okay?
Well, it's happened. Is that right? Did I get that right?
Got that right.
You got that right?
Well, that's the word.
Two out of two isn't bad, huh?
You share that, nice. Thank you.
First of all, on behalf of Fort Rucker, I'd like to thank Union Church for inviting us to come. Liberty Last Supper has been a tradition in military chapels since the 1950s. Fort Rucker has been doing it since 1979. So we actually have some men in the cast tonight who were not alive when this play first started happening at Fort Rucker. One of the things that we try to do every year is to present this as preparation of our own hearts for Easter, but also a way to give back to the community that's been so supportive of Fort Rucker. So we come by invitation to whichever church will have us. And this year, it just seemed like everybody wanted us to be Baptists. And that's okay, because I happen to be a Baptist. But the men and women that you'll see involved in this play all are in some way connected with military chapels. They have a couple things in common. They serve the country, and they serve the Lord. They're not professional actors by any stretch of the imagination. They're just people who love the Lord and want to share the message that Christ paid the price for our sins. I'd like to give you a few administrative instructions. There will come a point in this play when you'll actually be invited to come up to the table and share communion with Jesus and his disciples. The way this will work is our head usher, Mr. Frank Carbone, who's standing there in the center of the back, is going to come up and he'll escort the rows one by one. I think he's going to start on this side. Is that still right, Frank? And he'll ask you to come up this way, and you can scatter out anywhere along the table. What generally tends to happen is a lot of people want to get right in front of Jesus. But you can take communion in front of any of the disciples. You can even take communion in front of Judas if you want to. I can vouch for Judas. I am Mrs. Judas Iscariot. And the guy playing Judas is a Baptist preacher. So it's okay. But seriously, to keep a line moving, you can take communion anywhere along here and then come down this way. If there is someone who cannot, for various physical reasons, get up here to the table, when the usher comes, if you'll just quietly slip up your hand, we'll see to it that one of our cast members on the end brings communion to you. I'd like to explain how communion is going to be done, because it's a little bit different. Like I said, I am a Baptist, and I know Baptist communion wafers are little bitty tiny things, and you can't break them if you wanted to, and they're not very good for dipping. What we're going to do is you can come up here to the table and pinch off a piece of bread. This is a good size. And you'll dip part of the bread in the juice and then just bring the bread up to you to eat. Bread in the juice, not the fingers. Sometimes children or others in your audience may not be eligible under the rules of your church to take communion. We would still invite you to come up to the table and bring your children with you. They need to see communion modeled. So if you come anywhere along here, pinch off a piece like this, just go ahead and eat it. Because the bread will be partially dipped in the grape juice, and then you return to your seats with the help of the other ushers who will help you up and down the staircase. I want you to open up your bulletin for a minute, because this is the only time tonight you're going to be able to see your bulletin. We're going to turn the lights out. What you'll notice here is that we have the cast members and the narrator listed here. The way this play is done is it's based on the Da Vinci painting of The Last Supper. We brought our painting. If I'd known you had a big tapestry in your fellowship hall, I could have left that one alone. But it's based on the Da Vinci painting, and what will happen is each man will stand up in position when it's his turn to speak, and he'll deliver a dramatic monologue where each one of the disciples is considering his own walk with the Lord. What happened on the actual night of the Last Supper is that Jesus was celebrating Passover with his disciples, and he knew that he was going to go from that Passover table to Gethsemane, and that from Gethsemane he was going to go to Calvary, and that he was going to pay the price for our sins. But the Calvary wasn't going to be the end of the story. Easter was coming. Resurrection was on the way. But he had to pay the price for our sins first. So he's at the supper, and he has just revealed to the disciples that one of you is going to betray him. You may never have thought about it before, but it says a lot about the character of Jesus that none of those 12 men could possibly guess. Judas, who else? They is it I? Could I be the one to betray our Lord? And that's what we want you to get out of the play tonight. To take yourself out of 21st century Alabama and mentally and spiritually assert your own heart as the resurrection of the Lord is approaching and ask yourself, how am I in my walk with God? Am I truly living for Jesus, or could I be one to betray? It's a chance for you to get right with God if you're not already right, and to celebrate what Christ has done for you if you are. So we invite you now to put aside the cares of the world and to mentally take yourself to the upper room and join us for the Living Last Supper.
And the first day of unleavened bread, when they killed the Passover lamb, his disciples said unto him, Where wilt thou that we may go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover? And he sendeth forth two of his disciples, and saith unto them, Go into the city, and there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him. And wheresoever he shall go in, say ye to the good man of the house, The master saith, Where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. There make ready for us. And his disciples went forth and came into the city, and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And in the evening he cometh with the 12. And as they sat and did eat, Jesus said, Verily I say unto you, one of you which eateth with me shall betray me. And they began to be sorrowful, and say unto him one by one, Is it I? Is it I? Leonardo, versatile genius of the Renaissance, was born in Vinci, Italy in 1452. Though he excelled in many fields, he is remembered today because of two wonderful paintings, the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper. In 1494, when Leonardo was 42, he was commissioned by the Duke of Milan to decorate the dining room of the convent church, which was a favorite shrine of the Duke's young bride. As an appropriate theme for this dining room, the painter chose the Last Supper. His painting was not intended to be a faithful reproduction of the original scene as it had taken place in first century Judea, but as it might have taken place in 15th century Italy. He chose what he considered the most dramatic moment of the Last Supper. In this living dramatization, the 12 apostles speak their minds to themselves, to each other, and to the Lord in light of the words which they had just heard Jesus speak. One of you will betray me.
My name is Nathaniel. I'm also known as Bartholomew. And like several of the others, I'm a fisherman by trade. One day we were all on the road walking to Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus asked us, Who do men say that I am? Well, one said John the Baptist, another said Elijah, and several others said this prophet and that prophet. And then he stopped in the middle of the road, and he looked us right in the eye, and he said, Who do you say that I am? Well, before any of the rest of us could answer, Peter blurted out, You are the Christ! I've thought about that so many times since then, and I've come to the conclusion that this is indeed the defining question, the clarifying issue of our time. Who do you say Jesus is? Who is Jesus? Well, we walked with the Master for the better part of 3 years now, observing all that he has done and listening to all that he has said and all that he has taught, and based upon those things that we have seen him do and say, we all come to the same conclusion. He teaches with such great authority, unlike any of the scribes, authority that even commands the elements of nature to do this and to do that. The wind and the waves, they respond. They obey him. He has called out many unclean spirits from this person and that person, and the unclean spirits recognize his authority. They know who he is. They obey him. How many hundreds of thousands of men, women, boys, and girls we have watched him heal. heal of one infirmity after another, many of them infirmities that they had since they were born, and yet were just the touch of a hand or a soft-spoken word, infirmity was gone, as if it had never been there. How well I remember that day that we were all gathered in this house and he was teaching. And well, when word got out that he was there teaching, more people kept coming and coming, and it was so crowded that nobody else could get into that house. And all of a sudden, the ceiling, the roof opened up, and four men began to lower this paralytic in a bed right down before us, in the middle of the room. Jesus was so impressed with their faith. He looked at that paralytic and he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Well, there were some scribes and Pharisees in the house, and they began murmuring. And, you know, they accused him of speaking blasphemies, reasoning among themselves that only God could forgive sin. And they're right. But they did not comprehend who it was in their presence. Well, Jesus didn't let him get away with that. He called them out. Looked at him and he said, "Which is easier, for me to say your sins are forgiven, or to say to the paralytic, arise, pick up your bed and walk?" He didn't have an answer. So he said, "That you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins." And then he turned around and looked at the paralytic and he said, "Right, pick up your bed, go to your house." And he did. You should have seen the expression on the faces of those scribes and Pharisees. Their jaw dropped right down to the ground. I mean, Ron heard all this through. The Holy Spirit, the man of this day, Son of God, he is our Lord and our Savior. Now, he says, one of us who has been with me for 2 years now, one of us is going to betray me. I don't understand how that is possible. Betray the Son of God. Who can it be? Surely not John or Andrew.
Lord, is it I?
Wait, Zacchaeus, I'm a tax collector. Some call me Levi, others call me Matthew, public. By my association with Jesus, my character changed, and then my name as well. I'll never forget the first time the Master came before my tax table, and he spoke to me and talked. But then he asked me, "Come and follow me." I've been with him to this day. Shortly after he called me, I invited my other tax collector friends to my home for a large feast, and Jesus brought the other disciples. Then the Pharisees came. One Pharisee stood before Jesus and he said, "You would eat with these thieves, these sinners, these tax collectors?" "As you well know, those who are well have no need of a physician, only those who are sick." That was the day I gave my life to Christ. Someday I hope to write a book, a record of all the journeys that we took, like we went to the great Sermon on the Mount, and all those stories that Jesus spoke of. You know, the parables. And all the miracles. And in my own life, it only takes a moment for me to realize the miracles in my own life. How about you? And here tonight, our Lord has told us that one of us would betray him. Now, I know it would be real easy for all the other disciples to think, oh, it's Matthew, tax collector, because we know who he used to be. Then I had to think into my own heart. Could I do this? Is it I? Lord? Is it I?
I am James. Well, many men share this familiar name, so I am known as James, the lesser, for James the Little. My father's name is Alphaeus, so I'm also known as James, son of Alphaeus. I remember the first day I met the Master. I was walking alongside the river where John was baptized. Jesus was there asking John to baptize him. John refused, but the Lord insisted. After Jesus had been baptized, the heavens opened up. The Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove, and a voice cried out, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." About a year after his public ministry, Jesus chose me to be one of the 12 apostles. Since then, I have walked with him. I have talked with him. I have stayed with him, and I have prayed with him, trying to learn as much as I can about him and the Heavenly Father. And now, he says that one of us, one of the 12, is betraying him.